Okay, so let's say in the last two lectures we saw many points about characterizing and finding the properties of optimal transport plans, gamma, optimal transport map T. In particular, what we saw works well when the cost is a strictly convex function of the difference x minus y. We saw both the case in dimension one and higher dimension. I would like to start from some considerations about the cost. Where the cost is the distance. So about the distance cost. So when I say distance, I have in mind the Euclidean distance, C of xy equals norm of x minus y. Some of what I will say can be generalized to other distances. It will just be few observations. I will not enter into the discussion of how to prove that there exists an optimal transport map for this setting, because it would be quite long, and I will not develop it in the course, but I need some discussion about this to go to another chapter of the course, which is what is concerned with vast extent distances, that is using optimal transport to define a distance, and the starting point is to use the distance as a cost. So now a fourth fact is, what about C concave functions if C of xy is this. Now we have a proposition, very simple. A function u from, so in this case, okay, we can do it really in a general case, actually. So let's take a distance, the distance. And of course, in this case, I have to be on a space x cross x. I mean, I did the theory when you take a different space from the as a starting space and an arrival space. If you want to use the distance, it means that x and y must belong to the same space. Now, in this case, what I can say is that a function u is C concave for this cost if and only if u is Lipschitz with constant 1. If u is Lipschitz is constant 1, then uc is minus u. So it's a very simple characterization. In the case where the cost is the distance, and actually it's in the case where the cost is a distance, you could be in a metric space and use another distance, but typically we just use the Euclidean distance. Then being C concave means being one Lipschitz, and the transform just means changing the sign. The proof is quite easy. Suppose that u is C concave. Then it means that u of x is inf distance xy minus v of y. It's an inf over y. Now, it means that this is a family of functions parameterized by y of the variable x. V of y just plays the role of an additive constant, and this function is one Lipschitz. So this is an inf of one Lipschitz functions. You can prove by hand, if you don't know a general result, that inf of functions with a fixed modulus of continuity has the same modulus of continuity, but we already did for C. So we know that C concave functions have the same modulus of continuity of the cost. If the cost is the distance is one Lipschitz rest to itself. So the C concave functions are one Lipschitz. This is an implication. I mean, this is just proving the first part of the first line. Now, let's pass directly to the second part now, and then I will come back to the other implication. If u is one Lipschitz, let me compute uc of x. It's inf d of xy minus u of y, inf over y. And the first fact is that I observe that if I take y equals x, this is smaller than d of xx minus u of x, which is minus u of x. So this shows that uc is smaller than minus u because it's an inf and I can choose among the possible y equals x. But to say this, I'm not using that u is one Lipschitz. Now, if u is one Lipschitz, For every y, I have u of y, so I want to have a bound from below of d, so u of y is smaller than u of x plus distance xy. So distance xy minus u of y will be larger than minus u of x, just by using this inequality. Which implies that uc of x, which is the inf of this quantity, is larger than minus u of x. So if u is one Lipschitz, you have that uc is equal to minus u, because it's less than minus u for every function u, and if you use the condition of being one Lipschitz, you have the opposite inequality. So now this means that if u is one Lipschitz, then minus u is also one Lipschitz, and since we say that uc is minus u, this implies for every one Lipschitz function, sorry, for every u in Lip1, this implies that minus uc is u, and this implies that u is C-concave. So this also gives an answer to the first, to the other part. The converse implication in the first line. So when the cost is the distance, it's very, very easy to characterize a C-concave function. So in this way, the dual problem becomes just max integral of u d mu minus nu u, which is one Lipschitz. So this will be equal to min the distance cost d gamma gamma in pi mu. This is the main fact that I'm interested to. Just few words about the optimal transport map in this case, even if I say, as I said, I'm not so much interested in it. What about optimal maps T for C of XY is the cost, let's say the Euclidean distance. Remember that, so the Euclidean distance is a function of the distance, but it is convex, but not strictly convex. So this means that I cannot apply the theory that I developed before, because I cannot invert the gradient of h. And actually what I get is, I get gradient with respect to x of c of xy equals grad u of x. I'm just calling u the Kantorovich potential. By the way, the name Kantorovich potential originally was really used for the case of the distance cost. This means x minus y normalized if f x is different from y. So you see that knowing grad u gives you the direction of x minus y. So, and y will be t of x. So we know the direction of t of x minus x, but not its modulus. So it means that from the usual trick based on duality, you can deduce for each x, you can deduce in which direction you can move, but you cannot exactly find the point of x. It means that this is because this gradient is not injective. There are many points which have the same gradient, which are all the points on the same line. So you have ambiguity, you don't know how far to go. This can also be seen, from the condition, which was phi of x plus psi of y equals the cost, which can be written in this way now. For every xy in the support of gamma. That is, you have u, which is one Lipschitz, and gamma is concentrated on pairs, which saturate the constraint of being one Lipschitz. It means that if you have a point x and you transport its mass to a point y, then on this segment, the function u must be affine with slope 1. It's the only possibility, because if you exactly realize this equality so you have essentially one Lipschitz function which has a growth 1 between two points. The only possibility to stay one Lipschitz is that you can never be smaller, you can never be larger than exactly the affine function. So it means that u is affine on the segment xy with grad u, which is exactly equal to the, in this case, I think it is x minus y over x minus y. So you can also prove that if you have a one Lipschitz function, which is affine with slope 1 on a segment, then on this segment, the function is differentiable and the gradient is exactly oriented as the segment. In the sense that since you have a slope which is 1 in one direction and the function is one Lipschitz, it cannot have any other slope in other directions. But this shows that if x is sent to y, also all the other points on the segment could be possible points on which this equality is realized. So this shows, let's say heuristically, because I'm just giving a very vague discussion about this. This heuristically shows that transport occurs on segments. So a way to prove that there exists an optimal T is the following. Use U to fiber the space into a family of segments and the any optimal gamma will preserve these segments. So maybe I can give a name to the same family of segments S alpha. That is, if x, y is in the support of gamma, then there exists a same alpha such that x and y belong to the same segment. Now, of course, you have to prove that these segments are disjoint. So the segments, I said that the segments have this property that the function u is differentiable on each of the segments and the direction of the gradient is exactly, the modulus is one and the direction is exactly the direction of the segment. Now, this proves that it is not possible to have two segments which cross, because otherwise, what's the gradient here? So this is not possible. What is possible is that you could have segments which join on a common endpoint, because the argument to show that the function is differentiable only works in the interior. By the way, you can just imagine a function like, if you imagine a function like u of x equals norm of x, then it has many segments on which it is affine and they join on a common endpoint. So it's possible to have a situation like this, but you cannot have crossing. So you have to prove, and this is a non-trivial fact, you have to prove that the common endpoints are negligible, so you remove them. And after this, you have a disjoint family of segments. And what you know is that the transport works along each of these segments. And then, in some sense, you are brought, then we have a family of 1D transport problems. And for the case of 1D, even for the cost, which is the distance, we know that there is an optimal transport map, which is the monotone one, for instance. It is not the only one. The monotone map is an optimizer, but not the unique one, because of what we did in 1D, because of this very peculiar case that the monotone transport map is optimal for all the costs with power PP larger than one, and so as a limit, it's also optimal, but not a unique one for P equals one. There is a small point, which is that when we prove that in 1D, so in 1D, the monotone map is optimal if it exists. What do I mean? That I proved that I have a monotone graph, but this monotone graph could have vertical lines. And if you have a vertical line, then you're not the graph of a map. So what is the cause of vertical lines? Vertical lines means that you have an atom in your measure. If you have an atom in mu, in the original measure, then you have a vertical line that is one point which is sent to a bunch of points in the arrival. So what you have to prove is that when we transport a measure mu, let's say absolutely continuous with respect to the bag, to nu in RD, we have a family of measures mu alpha and nu alpha on S alpha. We need to prove that mu alpha has no atoms. Now, this family of measures, I'm not precise about it because I'm just telling you very vaguely what is the story of the problem. This family of measures is obtained by disintegration. So you have a measure on Rn, on Rd, you disintegrate along a family of segments, and you have to apply some abstract theorem saying that there exists a family of probability measure on each segment such that they reconstruct mu. We have to prove that mu alpha has no atoms. Now, the original, this approach dates back to Sudakov, a Russian mathematician in the 70s. So he published a proof of the fact that there exists an optimal transport map in the case where the starting measure is absolutely continuous. Here you really need absolutely continuous. Not giving mass to small sets is probably not enough. For instance, because the set of endpoints, you can prove that they are Lebesgue negligible, but it's not easy to prove that they are negligible for other, so that they are D minus one dimensional. So Sudakov published a paper proving that there exists an optimal T for distance cost, but he considered obvious that if a measure is absolutely continuous, then the disintegration on a disjoint family of sets should have no atom. And actually it's false. This was something which was found much later by Ambrosio and collaborators. So there is a paper with a counterexample to this, and then the way to fix the problem. So it seems that there is, this is false because you can find a family of disjoint segments such that the set of all the middle points of the segment has positive measures. So this means that if you disintegrate the Lebesgue measure along the segments, it's not possible that all the middle points have mass zero, have no atom, because otherwise the mass of the set of middle points disappears. So it's possible to find examples where the disintegration of an absolutely continuous measure, like the Lebesgue measure, on a family of disjoint segments, can create atoms in the disintegration. But this only happens if the segments are very rough. If you have a very mild regularity property on the direction of the segments, so if the map which associates with every point X the direction of the segment to which the point belongs, if this map has some regularity property, which means being essentially, for instance, being BV or being the key point is being countably Lipschitz, which means that you can remove a negligible set and then you can decompose into a countable union on each of these sets that this direction is Lipschitz, then you can get a nice disintegration result such that you don't have atoms. So it's an approach that makes to Sudakov, but he did not prove that mu alpha has no atoms. This was later fixed by Ambrosio around 2000. This is probably the main contribution by Ambrosio to the theory of optimal transport. Then he also worked a lot about gradient flows, but this is another part of it's not really the main theory of optimal transport, proving that the optimal transport exists. Of course, the idea is the one by Sudakov. Then it's a technical factor to prove that there are no atoms. Okay, this was what I wanted to say just as a story of the problem, the fact that Monge proposed the problem for the distance cost. And the distance cost is finally much harder to consider than the quadratic cost or strictly convex cost. Probably, so these last slides are just consideration, historical consideration. What I'm mainly interested in now is these considerations about the dual problem when you have the distance cost, which is just, which comes back to Lipschitz functions. So now I start keeping in mind what I said about the distance cost. I start a new chapter about Wasserstein distances. So what is Wasserstein distance? The idea is that you can use optimal transport to define distances on the set of measures. So take X equals Y, a subset over D. It could be generalized to other compact metric spaces. For simplicity, I will use the Euclidean setting because there are some statements that are easier to state in this setting. Compact. So when I say omega, it's not the open, it's the closed set. Take mu and nu probabilities on omega. Define, take P a number between 1 and infinity, define a quantity WP between mu and nu to be this one, minimum of the Kantorovich cost using as a cost x minus y to the P. I take this minimal value and then I take power 1 to the p. So it's a sort of LP norm. So you can also be written in this way. It's the mean of the LP norm of the function x minus y in LP of gamma. It can also be written as a mean of the LP norm of T minus the identity in LP of mu among maps sending mu to nu if there exists an optimal T in the, so the, let's say if the optimal gamma is of the form gamma T. So this last equivalence, it's passing from Kantorovich to Monge, essentially, only works if you are under assumptions which guarantee that you can, for which means P larger than 1 and mu absolutely continuous, for instance. By the way, the first lines are written in a symmetric way. It's symmetric in mu and nu. In the last line, you give a different role to mu and nu. So you could also write as a mean of transport maps going from mu to mu if nu is absolutely continuous. So this is a quantity. This is called, they are called Wasserstein distances, these quantities. So they are quantities which can be used to measure the distance between two measures using optimal transport ideas. I will discuss a little bit, I will prove all the mathematical properties, but also discuss the interpretation of these distances. Just a remark on the name, because it's very much debated. So there is a guy called Wasserstein who used this distance. He was not the first one to do this. He was not the one who made the most important results on this. He was not the last one. But for some reason, at the moment, people started calling this distance Wasserstein distance, to use the letter W. By the way, it seems that Kantorovich himself used the letter W, but W standing for work, in the sense of the work of a force. And so now everybody calls Wasserstein distance, and despite the attempts by many mathematicians, including Brenier and other colleagues, to call them, or in particular all the Russian school, they want to call this distance Kantorovich distances, or sometimes it is Kantorovich-Rubinstein distances. People in the applied community, in particular from computer science, in particular for p equals one, they call it the Earth movers distance. Which in some sense is how much do you have to move your Earth, your world, in order to transform mu into nu. But anyway, now it is called WP, and nobody will change the name, and I personally don't care. WP, it's okay. So this color called Wasserstein distances. What's their role? They are a sort of horizontal distances rather than vertical. So suppose, easiest case, take measures which have a density. Which kind of distances do you use on densities? So let me draw a density mu and another density, maybe I do it in green. So maybe these are two densities with the same integrals. So for instance, you can compute the L1 distance between the two. What is the L1? The L1 is you fix a point, you look at the value of the density here, you look at the value of the density here, you take nu of x minus mu of x. You look at this difference, this distance, and then you take an average. This is the L1 distance. If you want to do LP, okay, you average this in a different way. With LP, you can put a power P here and a power 1 over P here, and then you have this. But they are vertical, so you compare vertically the two graphs. Now, the idea of the Wasserstein distance is that if you have two densities like this, what you try to do is to see how much should you move your graph horizontally in order that the graph of mu becomes the graph of nu. Of course, you cannot just translate, unless the graphs are just one translation of the other. You have to do it in a way which is... I was disconnected. Sorry, something happened.
I mean, it was just a while we missed.
Okay. But do you okay. Still see my screen?
Yes, yes.
Okay, perfect, sorry. Okay. I'm even connected by cable, but sometimes the connection here at the university is not perfect. So I'm saying it's the question is how much should I move horizontally? So the true question is how much should I move horizontally the particles of mu in order to reconstruct the particles of nu and to compute an average. The average is in particular because the movement will not be uniform. So maybe some points will move more than others. I will do an average of horizontal displacement. There are some examples where you can really see that the two give different results, very different results. For instance, imagine the case where mu and nu are just the translation of each other. And suppose that you translate so much that they become that they have disjoint support. The L1 distance between the two will always be 2. So the L1 distance between two densities with disjoint support is 2. To probability densities, because when you integrate the modulus of mu minus nu, either it is mu or it is nu. So this is the integral of mu plus nu, and it is 2. So, and in particular, it does not depend on the geographical distance between the two supports. The two supports can be very close to each other or very far, and it does not depend on this. Then there is another example that is, suppose that you have a density mu which is highly oscillating. And suppose that you move it by one position. Do you want to consider that these two densities are very close to each other or not? In the L1, in the vertical sense, they are not close to each other at all because we have a lot of vertical difference. But in an horizontal sense, they are very close to each other. So oscillations can give large distances in the vertical sense, but small distances in the horizontal sense. In general, you can expect the vastness distance to be smaller than vertical distances. And in general, because in this case, it depends on displacement. And we will see in a while that the vastness distance is much more related to weak convergence than to strong convergence. So this is just a very vague interpretation with pictures of what is the vastness distance compared to other distances that you could know. It's also possible to do some explicit comparison between vastness distance and some negative Sobolev distances. So it can be compared to some norms, but you have to go to negative Sobolev spaces. That's why it's more related to a weak sort of convergence than to a strong one. So I want to really prove results. The first thing that I need to prove is that this is a distance. So proposition WP is a distance and it metrizes weak star convergence. Now this is on compact sets. So I insist on the fact that this result, in particular, the fact that it is related to weak star convergence, that it exactly it is exactly equivalent to weak star convergence, is true on compact set. If you are in non-compact domain, then you have to add something. So proof. What should I prove? First, that it is a distance. What does it mean that it is a distance? First thing that I want to prove is that, okay, this is positive. This is obvious from the definition, no? It's an inf of positive quantities. Now, suppose that WP mu nu is equal to zero. What can I deduce? By deduce, since it is a minimum, I can deduce that there exists a gamma in P mu nu such that the integral of x minus y to the P d gamma is zero. That is x minus y equals zero, gamma almost everywhere. It means it means that gamma is considered on the diagonal. I want to deduce mu equals nu. What I can say is that I take integral of phi d mu, I write it as phi of x d gamma, but this line says that for gamma, x and y are the same. So I take an arbitrary test function, I do integral of phi d mu, I write as phi of x d gamma, but gamma is concentrated on the set where x and y are the same, so I write as phi of y d gamma. Now I use the fact that gamma is a marginal nu, and I get that integral of phi d mu is the same as integral of phi d nu. For every phi, this means that two measures are the same. So WP is positive, it vanishes if and only if mu equals nu, so this, of course, WP of mu mu is zero. Use gamma is identity comma identity mu. So I have one fact, another fact, and another fact. The only thing which is missing to prove the triangle inequality. Now, this is not completely trivial. There is a case where it is easy to do, which covers most of the cases, but not all of them. So let's prove it, supposing that there exist optimal maps instead of Planck's gamma. So take three measures, mu, nu, and sigma. You take a map T from mu to nu and a map S from nu to sigma. And suppose that they are the optimal map. Now, Wp of mu sigma will be smaller than the Lp norm in mu of S composed with T minus the identity. In the sense that S composed with T, it's a transport map from mu to sigma, but it's maybe not optimal because I define it as the composition of two optimal transport maps. So I use T and S optimal maps. S composed with T, it's a transport map, but I have no idea if it is optimal or not. Now, I just have an inequality, but this is fine. It's the inequality that I can use. I bring this here. I use the triangle inequality for the LP norm. To move CEO's face. No, I don't. What has happened? Sorry. Ha. Okay. So I write in this way: S composed with T minus T plus T minus the identity. In LP of mu. Now, this is WP mu nu because I suppose that I use T optimal. What about this one? Now, let me write as an integral. It's S of T of X minus T of X P D mu of X and then power 1 over P. So I can use a change of variable and write that this is S of Y minus Y P D, the image of mu through T. So this means the LP norm of S minus the identity in LP of this image, which is nu. So it is WP nu sigma. So the triangle inequality is proven. Inequality is proven if there exist optimal maps from mu to nu and from nu to sigma. This works for p larger than one, mu and nu absolutely continuous. So I'm left to handle the case where they are not absolutely continuous and the case p equals 1. The case p equals 1 is easy. Since w1 of mu nu is a sup of integral of u d mu minus nu such that u is in leap 1. So essentially, I'm writing that this is the norm of mu minus nu in the dual of Lipschitz functions. It's enormous, so for sure it satisfies the triangle inequality. A possible way to show this is that W1 mu sigma will be the integral of U D mu minus sigma for an optimal U from mu to sigma. I write this integral as u d mu minus nu plus u d nu minus sigma, and each of these terms is smaller than the sup. So this proof for p equals 1 uses the duality. Since the dual is a sup, it works exactly the opposite way as I used to do. In this, instead of taking optimal competitors from mu to nu and from nu to sigma, I take an optimal competitor from mu to sigma, and then I use it as a non-optimal one from mu to nu and from mu to sigma. So p equals 1, it's clear that there is a triangle inequality. So now we are left to prove the case p larger than 1 if mu and nu are not absolutely continuous. And I will do it by approximation. So maybe I do a break in the proof of my theorem and just do a lemma to prove this approximation. And then I will come back to the second part of the statement, which is, and it matrices weak star convergence. So let me do like this, lemma. If mu epsilon is defined as a convolution of mu convolution with a standard regularization kernel, and the nu epsilon is the convolution with the same kernel of nu, then I have that WP mu epsilon nu epsilon tend, as epsilon tends to zero, to WP of mu nu. I think you agree that with this lemma it will be easy to conclude. I will take three measures, mu, nu, and sigma. We regularize all of them with the same kernel. The inequality will be true, and then I just pass to the limit. Proof. Proof of this result. The first part is, I will do an inequality in this way. So WP, mu, WP to the P, mu epsilon, nu epsilon, will be the integral of x minus y to the p d gamma epsilon optimal in pi mu epsilon nu epsilon. Now for this part of the statement, it will be the lower bound, the fact that this guy, the limit of this guy will be larger than this. For this part of the statement, I don't need that I have a convolution. I just need to have any sequence mu epsilon converging to mu nu. The fact is that up to subsequences, gamma epsilon will converge to something because it's a sequence of probability measures on a compact set, which means that let's take a compactly supported kernel. In this way, my measures were compactly supported because it was my assumption that I am on a compact space. I do a convolution with a compactly supported kernel. I don't care at all if I go out of my original domain omega. The statement is true for any domain in Rn. So the statement is true for compactly supported measure in Rd. So up to subsequence, I can assume this. And this quantity. Now, this is a continuous function. D gamma epsilon converges. So this is equal to Wp to the P mu epsilon nu epsilon converges to this. And they say that this is larger than WP to the P between mu and nu, since this will be an element of pi mu nu, because the marginal passed to the limit through weak convergence. Now, maybe this should be detailed here. Since I had phi d mu epsilon equals phi of x d gamma epsilon, this converges to phi of x d gamma, this converges to phi d mu, so I deduce that the projection of gamma according to x is mu, and the same for py. So it's easy to see that if I have a sequence of transport plans converging, weakly star converging, and the marginals converge, then the limit transport plan will have the good marginals. So this shows that WP to the P mu nu is less or equal than liminf of WP to the P mu epsilon nu epsilon. So it's the inequality. So this is smaller than this. Now, and here I did not use the convolution trick. For the convolution, for the other inequality, I will use the convolution. Now, note that mu nu sent to WPP mu nu, this is equal to sup phi d mu plus psi d nu such that something is a sup of linear functionals of mu and nu. So for each pair phi and psi, This is linear in phi in mu and nu. A soup of linear is hence it is convex. So this quantity, the wp to the p, and so in general any optimal transport cost, is a convex function of the measures. Moreover, it is also invariant by translations. That is, that if you define mu h to be the translation, so where you take tau h of x to be x plus h, if you define mu h to be translation of mu, nu h to be the translation of nu, then wp to the p of mu h nu h is the same of wp to the p mu nu. This now depends on the fact that we're using a transport cost, which only depends on the difference. Now, when you have a convex functional invariant by translation, then it decreases by convolution, because here we do, what is mu epsilon? Mu epsilon is the same as integral of mu h weighted with a measure on the possible h, which is a measure which is given by the convolution kernel. Mu epsilon is an average of translation, so a convolution is an average of translations. So this is an integral of measures. So it's an average of infinitely many measures. So wp to the p mu epsilon using convexity, it's smaller than the average of wp to the p mu h d eta epsilon of h. But this is equal to wp to the p mu nu d eta epsilon of h, which is equal to wp to the p mu nu, because this kernel integrates to one. So this is a general fact. A functional over any kind of functional space which is invariant by translation and convexity and convex decreases by convolution. So this proves that wp mu epsilon is smaller than wp mu nu, and it proves that the limit when epsilon tends to zero of wp mu epsilon is equal to wp mu nu, because we have the Lauer semi-continuity for any kind of approximation and the opposite bound for the convolution. So with this lemma, we take mu nu and sigma, we regularize, we write that wp mu epsilon is smaller than wp mu epsilon plus wp mu epsilon sigma epsilon. We let epsilon tending to zero and we get the triangle inequality.
Filippo?
Sì, si, yes?
There is a question.
Yeah, please.
Professor, what happens in the case that p is equal to 1 and mi and ni are not absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure? Does it fall into the previous?
So that's why I discussed the p equals 1 differently.
And we didn't use absolute continuity, right?
No, so we don't. Because I used the dual formulation and they proved the triangle inequality in a completely different way. Exactly because I didn't prove in this course that there exists an optimal map when mu and nu are absolutely continuous. So also this proof here with S and T, it doesn't work for p equals 1 with what we proved in the course, because I did not prove the existence of an optimal map when mu is absolutely continuous, even if it is true, but it's much harder to prove.
Thank you.
You're welcome. For the general case. So this closes the proof of the first part of the theorem, the fact that wp is a distance. Now, let's see which topology is induced by WP. First remark. Do you agree that W1 is more than WP? Remember that WP is defined as a minimal LP norm, LP with respect to a probability measure. So when you use probability measures with mass 1, the LP are ordered. So L1 is smaller than LP. So W1 is the smallest among these distances. But then I claim that I also have something like this. Diameter of omega to the power 1 minus 1 over P, W1 to the power 1 over P. So why? This is quite easy. Because I take x minus y to the P di gamma, and this is smaller than diameter of omega to the power P minus 1, x minus y di gamma. Now I take the inf, I add an inf over gamma here and here, and I get WP to the P between mu and nu smaller than this constant, W1 between mu and nu. And this gives this. So on a compact space, actually on a bounded space, all the WP induce the same convergence. Now, what I want to prove is that W1 mu n mu tends to zero if and only if mu n weakly star converges to mu. This is what I want to prove, that converging in the sense of the vast and distance, which vast and distance? I don't care, they all give the same topology. They are all equivalent in a certain sense. Is equivalent to converging in the weak star sense, that is in duality with all continuous functions. Remember that I am on a compact space, so continuous functions are a Banach space and measures are the dual of this Banach space. Now let's do this proof. So if W1 mu n mu tends to zero, it means that for every u which is leap 1, I have this integral which tends to zero, because actually it's even a sup over u. So this means that I have this which tends to the integral of u d mu for every which is Lipschitz. I mean, if it is true for Lipschitz one function, I can multiply times a constant and I get the same result for all Lipschitz functions. Lipschitz functions are dense in C of omega, and this implies that in the end this will be true for all continuous functions. It's not completely clear. So is it true that I can test weak convergence on a dense set? Yes and no. Yes, I can if I already know that I'm bounded. And here I'm bounded because I have probability measures. So the true result is like this. Take phi, which is continuous, take epsilon positive, there exists u, which is Lipschitz, such that u minus phi in an infinity norm is smaller than epsilon. This is just a density result, and actually we know that even infinity functions are dense, even polynomials are dense, and so on. And then phi d mu n minus phi d mu will be bounded by the twice u minus phi infinity. Why twice? So here I change phi into u. I have to pay u minus phi times the mass of mu n, but mu n is a probability. And here I do the same, plus the integral of u d mu n minus mu. So this guy is smaller than 2 epsilon plus something which tends to zero. So if I take the limit, is smaller than the limit here, which is smaller than 2 epsilon plus 0. So this limit is smaller than 2 epsilon, so it's equal to 0. So this proves convergence of the integrals of any continuous function. So essentially of any function which is taken in a set which is in the closure of this one. Closure for the norm, for the L-infinity norm, which is okay because it's so for the unit, for the subnorm, because these are measures and so they are in the good duality. So this is okay. For the opposite, if I know, so I know mu n weak star converge to mu, and I want w1 mu n mu tending to zero. Now, w1 mu n mu will be equal to the integral of a certain one Lipschitz function d mu n minus mu. Now, since this is one Lipschitz, I can assume that un, so I can always add the constant to un. So for instance, I can assume that the average of un is zero. Because if I add the constant to un, I add it here and I subtract it here. So it means also that un is bounded by the diameter of omega. So the sequence un is equicontinuous and equibounded. Because of Ascoli-Arzelà, I have a subsequence which uniformly converges to U. So if I look at the result on the subsequence, I can write in this way if you want. It's the duality product between a continuous function and measures, but this converges strongly to U and this converges weakly to zero, and so it converges to zero. So on a subsequence, I can prove that this W1 tends to zero. Usual trick to get rid of the subsequence, I first extract a subsequence which realizes this lim sup of this W1 distance, and then I extract from it and I prove that the lim sup is zero. So I'm done with this proof, which says that we know what is the topology of the vast end distances. The topology of vast end distances is the weak star topology. So this is a very useful quantity because it metrizes a convergence which is very much used, and it has also a nice interpretation in the sense of resultant displacement. I don't know if you have questions on these proofs and on these results which I proved. If not, so we have now a metric space. Just so maybe I can just write this. Observation, this does not work if omega is not compact. The result in this case is that WP mu n mu tends to zero if and only if two conditions are satisfied. Mu n weakly convert, okay, if this, let's write in this way, if and only if for every function phi which is continuous on omega and which satisfies something like this, I have integral of phi d mu n tending to integral of phi d mu. That is, the convergence in WP, if you are in an unbounded set, is equivalent to the convergence in duality with all the continuous functions which have a growth of order p. In particular, you want integral of x to the p d mu n converging to the moment x to the p d mu, which is obvious that you should require this because this is wp to the p between mu n and the delta in zero. And in a metric space, if mu n tends to mu, the distance to a fixed point should converge to the distance to the fixed point. So you in general, you state weak star convergence in duality with So continuous functions if you are in a compact space. Otherwise, it could be continuous and bounded, continuous and vanishing at infinity. Here you need more. You need continuous and growing at infinity at most as power p. So for every function phi for which there exists a constant such that phi is probably I should write in this way, every function phi such that sup phi over this is finite, which is another, it can also be used as another normal detector space, the space of all functions with a certain growth. So it's duality with something else, which depends on P. Now it is no more true that the convergence does not depend on P. And the equivalences between W1 and WP, which are based on this inequality, of course, they fail if you are in an unbounded domain because the emitter is not finite. This is still true. W1 is still smaller than WP, but WP cannot be compared to W1. Another remark, observation one, observation two, we could define W infinity as the mean of the L infinity norm now for this. You see that this inequality again fails because you take, okay, if P is equal to infinity, you cannot compare anymore WP to W1 because here you get an exponent zero. Now it's not true anymore that W infinity mu n mu tends to zero if and only if mu n converges to mu. For instance, take mu n to be 1 minus 1 over n delta in 0 plus 1 over n delta in 1 and mu to be delta in 0. Because when you transport mu n onto mu, there is some mass which should move from 1 to 0. Less and less mass, but if you compute the infinity norm, of the displacement, the infinity norm will always be one. There is always some mass which is transported at distance one. The amount of this mass is tending to zero. But since you're not doing an LP norm but an L infinity norm, you get this is equal to one, even if you converge weakly, and even actually you converge very strongly. So this W infinity does not become any more comparable to weak convergence and not even to strong convergence. Because mu n converges strongly to mu in the space of measure, in the sense of the norm of the measures, but does not converge in W infinity. So that's what I wanted to say on the topology of the Vastan spaces. Now I would like to go on, if you don't have questions, to go on with curves in the Vastan spaces. One of the goals later on in the lectures of next week will be to study PDEs which are related to curves in the Vastan space. Because when you have a curve in the Vastan space, it means that you have a curve of measures. So you have time, and then for each time you have a measure. Imagine that you have a density, it means that you have a function of time and space. And you can look at which is the connection with PDEs solved by this function. And we will also see it now, there are some connections with some PDEs. But before doing this, I need to recall some language from curves in metric spaces. So even if I decide to stick to the Vastan space on the Euclidean space, so I use FD, I use the cost function, which is the Euclidean distance and so on. Even if I decide to do this, now I have a distance on the set of probabilities on this simple space, which is the Euclidean space. But so in the end, I have a metric space, which is the space of probabilities endowed with distance WP. So if I want to study curves in the Vastan space, I need to know something about curves valid in metric spaces, which are not, because of the fact that these distances are horizontal and not vertical, they are in general not norms, except for the case W1, where I use the fact that W1 is a norm. So W1 between these two measures is a norm. By the way, it means that if you add a common measure to mu and nu, the distance will not change. This is not true for other p. This is specific to p equals 1. So W1 only depends on the difference, where Wp can depend also on the common mass between mu and nu. So if you are valid in a vector in a metric space which is not a vector space with a norm, we have to be clear about some notions about what we mean for curves and so on. So the first notion is what is an absolutely continuous, so some definitions, absolutely continuous curves. So imagine that you have a curve omega from an interval of time valid in X, XD metric space. And in the end, our metric space will be the space of probabilities endowed with D to B WP. I say that omega is absolutely continuous if there exists a function G in L1 of 0t such that the distance between omega t and omega s can be bounded by the integral from s to t, well, here let's say t larger than s, of g over dr. So this is a generalization of Lipschitz curves. If g is a constant, then your Lipschitz. So, I mean, absolutely continuous in the particular case where g is a constant means that you are Lipschitz with a Lipschitz constant which is equal to the value of g. If you accept that g is L1 instead of just a constant, instead of bounded, you accept Mur curves. And actually, it's exactly what you do with one-dimensional subless spaces. This is, morally, this is the space W11. It's the space of functions which have a derivative, which is L1. Now, you cannot speak of derivatives because you are in a metric space. So, effect, if omega is a C, there exists omega tilde reparametrization of omega, which is Lipschitz. The idea is that since G is L1, the total mass of G will be finite, and then you will stretch time, compose with a homeomorphism of 0t, in order to make the speed at which the distance increase constant. Now, another fact is that, okay, I spoke about speed, I spoke about derivatives because AC should be like W11, but I cannot speak about derivatives because I'm in a metric space. Let's define what we can about derivatives. Let's define what is called the metric derivative, which we could roughly call speed of a curve. So I define, can I define omega prime of t to be the limit as h goes to zero of omega t plus h minus omega t over h? Of course I can't, because omega is valid in metric space and not in a vector space, so I cannot take differences, I cannot divide by scalars. But remember, what is the norm of this? This is equal to this. Let's say like this. And so this notion can be translated into a metric setting. If every time that you have a modulus of a difference, you replace with a distance. So this is the definition. I call metric derivative of a curve at time t the limit, if it exists, of the distance between omega t plus h and omega t divided by the modulus of h, and I let h tend to zero. A theorem is that if omega is absolutely continuous, then there exists, if it exists and is finite, there exists omega prime of t for almost every t. Now, if you use this fact, it's not difficult to see that it's enough to prove it for Lipschitz curves. And because this reparametrization will be a monotone map from the interval to itself, and if you are able to prove it on a to prove this result on a reparametrization, then to translate into the original curve, you just need the reparametrization of homomorphism is differentiable almost everywhere, and monotone curves, monotone maps from the interval to itself, are monotone functions in 1D are differentiable almost everywhere. So you can prove it for Lipschitz, and for Lipschitz function, this is sort of variant of the extension of the Rademacher theorem, which says that the Lipschitz functions are differentiable almost everywhere. And how to prove it? It would be nice. So if instead of being in a metric space, you are in Rn, you just prove it component wise. If you are in a space like, so this is proven by injecting X into the metric, the very particular metric space, which is the space of bounded sequences with the sup distance, so small L infinity, it has the advantage of being a very strange metric space, but it's it has components. So you can prove component twice, and it has a countable number of components. So you can prove component twice the result when you are valued in L infinity, prove that it works, that the fact that the distance is defined as the sup of the distances between components, it let the result work also for L infinity. And then you can prove that every compact metric space admits an isometric embedding into L infinity. So every compact metric space can be isometrically embedded into L infinity using a dense sequence xk, and then you send x into the sequence distance between x and xk. So if you are in a compact metric space, it is separable. So there exists a countable dense sequence, and then you use it to do an isometric embedding, because you send every point x to the sequence of all the distances to these points xk, and you can prove that the distance between x and y is the sup over k of the distance between xk minus the distance y xk norm modulus. So the idea is, use the fact that L infinity as some components to use real valid functions and embed every compact metric space I said compact, but here it would be enough to be separable and bounded. Okay, I will not prove this theorem, it's just a remark. So this is about metric derivatives. Other remarks about these quantities. If omega is in AC, then the length of omega, which is defined as the sup of the sum of the distances between omega ti and omega ti plus one, I from one to from zero to n minus one, among all partitions t zero smaller than t one, smaller than t n, and this is zero t. If omega is in this length, is equal to integral of omega dot. Also, omega dot is the smallest L1 function G that we can use in the inequality which I use to define the fact of being absolutely continuous. And then a last remark, which will be useful later, finding geodesics in X amounts to solving a sort of calculus operation problem, minimum of omega dot with fixed initial and final point. But if I solve instead, so a geodesic, you know that finding a geodesic in a space means finding curves of minimum, so I want absolutely continuous curves, which have initial and final points which are fixed, and I minimize the length. If I solve instead another problem, which is the one where I minimize the metric derivative to the power p with the same constraints, I find constant speed geodesics. So, you know, geodesics are, so the length is invariant by reparametrization. So geodesics are never unique because you can always reparametrize them. A nice way of reducing the non-uniqueness is to fix that you want geodesics with constant speed. So you choose a parametrization such that, what does it mean constant speed? It means that omega dot is constant. And this is a very simple observation, this one, because you just do this. Indeed, this integral by Jensen is larger than this one. And by definition, and this is larger than the minimal length to the power p. I mean, take an arbitrary curve omega joining two points and compute this quantity. It's larger than computing this other quantity, which is larger than compute the minimal value of this, minimal possible value of this quantity to the power p. Now, here you have equality if and only if omega is a geodesic. By definition, what is geodesic? It's a curve which minimizes this quantity. And here you have equality if and only if this is constant. So globally, you get that the minimum of this quantity, so the minimum of the integral of the power p of the velocity, is equal to the minimal length to the power p, and it is realized by constant speed geodesics. This is because you can produce constant speed geodesics. If geodesics exist, then you can reparameterize them with constant speed. Now, the fact is that this is if geodesics exist. In compact spaces, in compact space, let's say they do, provided there exists at least a finite length curve connecting any two points. This is also another effect from metric geometry. You can, or metric analysis if you want, given two points, you can consider the space of all curves connecting them and prove that there exists a minimizer of the length, in particular because if you write the length in this way, it's clear that it is something lower semi-continuous for the weak convergence because it's a soup of continuous quantities for the pointwise convergence even. So this was a certain list of properties about curves valid in metric space. I gave some definitions with some theorems, also some facts and some theorems. Now, with this introduction, I want to state the main theorem about absolutely continuous curves in the vastness space, and then we will start commenting on it, why it should be true, why do we state in this way, and so on. And I think the proof will probably be mainly next time. So, absolutely continuous curves in the space WP. I will really start from the theorem, and then we will discuss. Theorem. A curve, mu t in 0, 1, is absolutely continuous for the WP distance, take P larger than 1 and omega inner V compact. So if a curve is absolutely continuous for the WP distance, then for almost every T, there exists a vector field VT, which belongs to LP of mu T, valued in the vector space, such that dt mu plus divergence of mu z v equals 0. We'll discuss what do I mean by this equation, in which sense, and vt in LP of mu t is smaller than the metric derivative of the curve mu seen as a curve valued in the vastness space. First part of the statement. Second part of the statement, if mu t is a curve such that there exists a family, such that for almost every t, there exists vt in LP of mu t with dt mu plus divergence of mu v equals 0 and a certain integrability of the LP norm, then mu is absolutely continuous as a curve. So now, sorry, it's a curve valued in measures. I'm not speaking at all about the fact that these measures are absolutely continuous related to the bag. I'm speaking about the fact that the curve is absolutely continuous in time. It's the same terminology. There is a connection, of course. It's the fact that the derivative is an absolutely continuous measure, but it can be ambiguous, and I'm sorry for this, but I can't do anything. Mu is absolutely continuous, and this is smaller than this. So, essentially, this theorem characterizes the family of absolutely continuous curves valued in the space WP as the solution of this equation, which is called the continuity equation, with an LP velocity field. So now I would like to discuss this theorem in its role, and in particular discuss the role of this equation. Why this equation appears. So you see that we're starting to have PDEs. There is a connection between derivative in time and derivative in space. This is divergence in space, because this is a measure times a vector. You have a vector measure, it's a vector field, and you take its divergence. And there is a connection between the speed of the curve in the vastness space and the LP norm of the velocity field in the space mu t. This works for P larger than 1. There is, I would say that probably the second part is also true if for P equal 1, but the first, so the fact that there exists a velocity field doesn't work for P equals 1. So, comments on the statement.
Filippo,
please.
Okay, maybe it will be in your mind. I just want to make precise the sense in which you define the equation.
Yes, yes.
I think it is maybe in the comments or something like that.
Yes, yes, I need to do it. Yes, of course. Yes. This is really, I want to speak about the continuity equation. Now, the first thing that I want is the meaning. Exactly, I agree with you, Alessio. What's the meaning that they give to this? The meaning of dt mu plus divergence of mu v equals 0. The first, so there are two possible definitions. Let's use the first one. So I mean, by definition, I mean for every phi in C1 of omega, I want that if I differentiate in time phi according to mu t, so I want these to be absolutely continuous in time, and its time derivative to be the integral of grad phi dot vt d mu t. An equivalent definition is that for every psi, which is C1 of 0t times omega, I want the integral of dt psi d mu t, so this is a double integral in time and space, plus grad psi, so this in space, dot vt d mu t. This should be equal, if I'm not wrong, to psi d mu 1, ma psi 1 d mu 1, so psi, let's write in this way, sorry, psi of 1x d mu 1 of x minus psi of 0x d mu 0 of x. So this is an equivalent definition. You can pass from one to the other if you use you use psi of tx of the form a of t phi of x with arbitrary a, then you can deduce that this one implies this one. So here I use as a test function a function of space only, and I require that the integral of this function of space integrated according to mu t gives a result depending on t. I require a formula on its derivative in time. Here I use, this is essentially the distributional definition with function of time and space. Of course, if I take functions which are not compactly supported in time, so they have a value on 0 and t, you have a boundary term here. Let me discuss now about the boundary term in space. So if I apply this to psi of the form phi times a function depending on t, you get a weak formulation of this. You get, in the sense that you get a prime of t times the integral of psi d mu t, of phi d mu t, sorry, equals something. So plus a of t times grad phi d vt mu t equals something. And by integration by part in time, you get this. You exactly get this formula. You also get the fact that you are absolutely continuous in time because you are providing a weak derivative. So you prove that this is Sobolev in time. Actually, it will be probably Lipschitz in time in using C1 functions. So this is what I obtain if I pass from the second definition to the first. To pass from the first to the second, you have to use the same trick, but then you have to use that this family of functions generate a dense family in the set of all functions of two variables. So what I mean is that from the first definition only uses function of space. You can deduce from this result for psi of the form of function of time times function of space with the same trick. But it means that you only have this result not for every C1 function, but just for functions which are of the separable form. Finite combinations of separable functions form an algebra which can be proven to be dense with the Stone-Weierstrass theorem. It has to be proven. Usually I prefer this formula here. And now, what about the boundary in space? Because formally, note that formally, d over dt of phi d mu t should be equal to phi dt mu t. And so if this, if dt plus divergence is zero, so here I write minus phi divergence of mu v, and then I integrate by part, and it is phi, so grad phi dot mu v, but there is also minus a boundary term. So the fact that I don't put this boundary term, the absence of the term on the omega, means that I impose this equal zero, which is what is called the no-flux boundary condition. It's a sort of Neumann boundary condition. It's not called Neumann because Neumann means the normal derivative is equal to zero. This is the normal component of something must be equal to zero. There is no flux through the boundary. This is absolutely what I needed to expect if I want to model a curve on in the vastness space of a given omega, because they are all probabilities probability measured on omega. The mass does not change, the mass does not pass through the boundary. It models conservation of mass. On omega, no mass passes through the boundary. So this equation, now I want to say this equation, it is called the continuity equation, is the equation which comes in physics and more precisely in fluid mechanics from the conservation of the mass. So this is the mathematical description. So what does it mean? Let us be precise. I think it answers your question, Alessio. This is the definition that I want to give, and it includes, so I could have written this together with no flux boundary condition, but let's say that this is my definition. I take C1 function in omega, and I, you see that I didn't put compactly supported. These functions can be whatever I want on the boundary. So I'm imposing that no mass passes through the boundary. Another observation is
Sorry, just a minor point, Filippo. When you start from the equation, you start from a V, which is itself, a measurable function of Tx, or it's defined for every T or what? I don't know. It's
okay. You can imagine that it is okay. I agree that if I write like this, I'm not imposing any measurability of in T. No, that's what which is annoying for you, probably.
Yeah, or even when you start from the equation, of course, you have written this VT with this subscribe. So,
Yes. No, I agree. It should be a measurable function of T and X, I think.
Okay, so it's a measurable function.
It is true that it is a choice that you do for every T, but it should probably be measurable in T.
I was wondering if you were using some selection or just, starting from a measurable function and then, almost every...
It's also the way it will be constructed. It's acting on time space. So it's a function of T and X, which will be measurable. And it will be seen as a density of something with respect to the measure which is the integral in time of the mu t, let's say the measure which is a measure on time space. So it will be on time space. It's this writing is not precise. Yes.
No, it was just to make precise. Thank you.
Which is the same as what you want if you require that is measurable in t, which is I agree. I'm not insisting enough on measurability, and it's really a choice. Much. So this is the mathematical definition. The physical meaning is this one. Suppose that you have a bunch of particles which follow some trajectories that I will call y, and you know the velocity field at each instant of time and each position. So v of Tx is the velocity at time t at point x. Suppose that the velocity, you have a particles which move, and every time that you know t and x, the position, you know the velocity. So you solve this equation. Now maybe you can call yx the solution if you impose y of 0 equals x. Now suppose that V is Lipschitz. essentially it's Lipschitz in X. So the D in this case, the Cauchy-Lipschitz theorem gives you that for every X there exists a unique solution that they call YX. Now consider the map YT of X, which is defined in this way, that is YT goes from omega to omega or from RD to RD, and it is the position at time t of the particle which was originally located at X. Now, suppose if you have given mu zero, define mu t to be the image at time t of mu zero. Then mu t and v solve dt mu plus divergence of mu v equals zero, exactly in the sense that I was giving. Proof: you differentiate in time the integral of a test function d mu t, but this can be written as phi of yt d mu zero. Now you have to differentiate here, so it's a differential of a composite function. It's grad phi yt dot the derivative, but the derivative is given by v. And then you see that you have again a composition with yt, so it will be grad phi dot vt d mu t. So this flow is well defined if v is nice, for instance Lipschitz. These flows can be used to move the particles. If you know the initial distribution of the particles, you can deduce the distribution at time t, and you can see that the mass distribution at time t solves, together with the velocity field, the continuity equation. And this continuity equation is exactly the equation which in mathematical physics describes the conservation of the mass, which does not disappear, it moves following a certain vector field. Another fact is that if Vt is Lipschitz for every t and maybe uniformly, so let's say that Lip Vt is smaller than c, then the solution of dt mu plus divergence of mu v equals zero with mu at time t equals zero given is unique. So it's a sort of measure valued equivalent of the Cauchy-Lipschitz theorem. If you have a velocity field which is Lipschitz in space, uniformly in time, for instance, then the solution of the continuity equation is unique given the initial data. It's unique and it is given by mu t equals the one that I just showed, since it is unique. So what happens is that if v is not Lipschitz, maybe you can find a flow, in the sense that maybe if v is not Lipschitz, maybe you can find a solution to this. For instance, if v is continuous, it is well known that the solution exists, but they are not unique. If v is continuous, you have solutions of these, and you can prove that the image measure also solves this equation, but maybe it's not the unique solution. Now, if v is Lipschitz, you have a unique solution. So this is the interpretation, it's a point that we will use. So this explains, I think it's possible now from this connection to understand why there is the LP norm of the velocity field which appears in this statement. Because what is the Vastan distance? The Vastan distance is the LP norm of the displacement. Now, what is the velocity in a metric space? It's a sort of infinitesimal distance. You have to replace the displacement with the velocity. So if you imagine that your curve mu comes from a flow as here, the distance, now maybe we can also really, so in this case, it's reasonable to guess that we have something like this, WP between mu t and mu s. It's probably something like, so what I'm claiming here is not true, but in inequality at least it's true. when you compute the distance between one measure and another, for sure, so this is true, because you can prove that this is a way of coupling the, so YT, YS, image mu zero, this is a coupling, a transport plan between mu T and mu S. So this inequality is true. What I claim is that most likely this, for if T is very close to S, will probably be will probably be almost true as an equality. And now this is something like T minus S to the power P and then power 1 over P of dT yt power P d mu 0. If y is differentiable in time, the difference yt minus ys will be the difference in time times the derivative, something like this. And now this is v. This is exactly the same computation that we had before. This is v of t yt. And so in the end, you get the LP norm of vt in LP of mu t, because you have this power p d mu 0, but since you integrate a function according to mu zero, but it is composed of yt, you get mu t. So it's quite, so you can understand essentially this inequality. If instead of using the inequality here, so the almost equality, use the inequality, this is essentially the proof of the second part of the statement, because it means that if you have a curve which is obtained from a certain flow, and you know the LP norm of the velocity field, then you deduce a bound on the distance between mu t and mu s. Now, what I wrote here is the distance between mu t and mu s is smaller than t minus s times this time derivative. Of course, I have to quantify this also, but it's possible to do everything. It's almost the proof of the second part of the statement, up to the fact that this works if V is Lipschitz. And here I'm just saying that it is true if V is LP, which is much less, I have no regularity. So there will be an approximation behind this. And there is also another part of the statement, which is the opposite, which in some sense is the fact that I can transform this inequality into an equality. And I can find a V which satisfies this. Now, this will not, I will not be able to do it now because I only have a few minutes left, and I will just discuss a little bit some other points that I want to use and which suggest some consideration for next time, and then next time we will have a proof of this theorem and some other properties about curves on the vastness space. So probably compared to what I wrote, the full proof of this will be next time. And now I will discuss a little bit something about the geodesics, because this theorem, so another observation is this theorem provides a nice interpretation of constant speed geodesics in WP. Because remember that in order to find a constant speed geodesic, I need to do something like this, with, of course, initial and final conditions which are fixed. Now, here I'm doing a choice, which is a choice which is very convenient, but it's not compulsory at all, that I'm choosing the same P here and here. In the sense that when I write this, metric derivative, this metric derivative depends on the distance that I use. So if I use the space of measures, I have to decide which distance WP I use. Now, if you choose a certain P, then let's decide that we look for constant speed geodesic by minimizing a power of the velocity, the integral of the power of the speed, but I choose the same power as the exponent P. Why? Because this to the P is just the LP norm
to the P, so it's just an integral in space of Vt to the P d mu t. Now, the theorem, you can see that, okay, this is the characterization of absolutely continuous curves, but in particular, I have two inequalities which are opposite. So in the end, what I'm claiming is that the metric derivative of the curve is equal to the LP norm of the velocity field. Which velocity field? Notice that here, what I'm saying is that there exists one with a good value of the LP norm, and for every other one, I have this inequality. So actually, in this equation, I could have several V for the same mu. More or less, the idea is add a zero divergence vector field. So it's not exactly add the zero divergence V, it's add the velocity field V such that mu V has zero divergence and the equation will not change. So there are several Vs which solve the same equation. The one with minimal norm will have this LP norm equal to the velocity in the vastness space, equal to the metric derivative. The others will have higher norms. So if I want to minimize this mu, this will be, in the end, will be this velocity, a minimum of a double integral in time and space of mu t vt to the power p. So it will be a dx, so it's not really a dx, it's a d mu t and then a dt among pairs, so which are solutions of the continuity equation with given initial and final point. So finding geodesics in the WP space, constant speed geodesic, will amount to solving a minimization problem under a PDE constraint and minimizing this kind of kinetic energy. For P equals 2, you have the kinetic energy in the classical sense, where the kinetic energy is given as product of mass times velocity square. With another P, this is a sort of generalization of the kinetic energy. Now, we will also discuss next time the role of this problem for numerical approximations, because this was this problem. This is called the Benamou-Bernier formulation. We will also see the connection between finding geodesics and finding the optimal transport. There is a connection. I did not discuss which are the geodesics, but if you want to find the geodesic in the vastness space, you can solve this. Now, why is this useful for numerics? It becomes a variational problem with a PDE constraint, and it is convex, but it is not easy to see that it is convex, because the unknown are two unknowns. So this is a mean over mu and v, no? I have an equality constraint. If I want a problem to be convex, and they have an equality constraint, as I also said the first time, the only hope is that the equality is linear. And this is not linear because there is a product mu v. Anyway, the function mu v to the p is not convex in mu and v, because in general, the products are not convex function. So there is a trick to make it convex. This minimization problem is convex if I write E equals mu v, and it becomes mean of, instead of mu v to the p, this is, so I can write in this way, this such that I have dt mu plus divergence of E equals zero, and of course mu zero and mu one fixed. So now my new unknowns are mu and E. Mu is so you can see it as a measure on 0, 1 cross omega, but it is a particular form. It is obtained as a family of probability measures. And E will be a vector measure on 0, 1 cross omega. And when I write E over mu, so this quantity, uh, will be defined in this way, will be defined as the integral of v to the p d mu if E is absolutely continuous with respect to mu, and I call V the density, plus infinity if it is not absolutely continuous. Now, what we will discuss it next time, we will need to prove that this function is convex. This essentially comes from the convexity of a function of two variables, which is x to the p, y to the p minus one. This function can be shown to be convex, with some distinction to be made on the fact that y cannot vanish, y should be positive, and so on. But y plays the role of mu. Mu is a measure which is positive, so because they are probability measures, and E is a vector field. So this this functional will also be very useful in the proof of this theorem. So the first time that I will prove next time is to give a precise definition of this functional and prove that it is convex, lower semi-continuous, which property does it have. And we will then be able to prove this theorem. Then what we will do next time is also to study the geodesic in the Vastan space and to explain what are the connections between geodesic and optimal transport, so that if we are able to solve numerically this Benamou-Bernier problem, we are also able to find the optimal transport. And maybe if time permits, I will also say something about the numerical solution. So it's just the fact that this is a convex optimization problem. I don't know if I will insist a lot on the convex optimization tricks to solve this. We will discuss, we will be mainly concerned with the proof of this characterization of absolutely continuous curves and the role of geodesics in the Vastan space. I think I stop here for today, and I thank you again, as usual, for your attention.
Thank you, Filippo. Thank you very much. Of course, if there are questions, feel free to. Okay, Stefanos.
So, Professor, depending on the discussion about geodesics we had before, can we eventually say that under appropriate conditions, our transport plan will be supported on the geodesics under the Wasserstein distance?
What does it mean? So there is a connection between some transport plan and geodesics. But what does it mean this? Because transport plan is a measure on pairs x and y. Now, there is a connection between the optimal transport plan gamma and the geodesic. It's a connection which I can also write, but we will prove it later, is that if you have an optimal transport plan, which is a probability in omega times omega, then you define this projection pi t from omega cross omega to omega, which is pi t of xy is 1 minus tx plus ty, the middle point between x and y. And then if you define mu t to be pi t image of gamma, then this mu t is a geodesic which connects mu 0 to mu 1. So you can build geodesics starting from optimal transport plans. And you can also see that the movement of the particles, each particle will follow a geodesic itself, because this is the geodesic from x to y. It's the constant speed geodesic from x to y. If instead of being in the Euclidean space, you are in a more general metric space or on a manifold and so on, this map should be replaced by following the constant speed geodesic from x to y and looking at where it is at time t. So there is a connection. But the question itself, the transport plan is considered on geodesic, does not mean exactly what you probably mean.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so there seems that there are no other questions. Okay, so again, we thank Filippo for this third lesson. It was a very intense week, but very nice. And so we will see you again on Monday.
So Monday morning,
11 o'clock. okay?
At 11 o'clock, exactly. We meet on Monday at 11. I will save this PDF and put it online here. I will update the web page with the references for yesterday and today, and also to update the program, because something which was originally scheduled to be done today, it will be next time, because actually it was quite an ambitious day today. And so next time we'll be again discussing about curves and geodesics in the Western space. And then the last two lectures will be about particular curves in the Western space, that is, will be about which curves can I obtain as gradient flows in the Western space, and I will try to use the theory to provide some solution to some PDEs.
Okay. Okay, so I thank okay. you.
Hi, guys. Thanks. Bye, everybody.
Thank you very much. Have a nice lunch.
Lunch, yes.
Thanks, bye.
Just here, everybody is already at lunch, I think, here in the lab.
Thank you very much. Bye. Thanks. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. Ciao. Buon pranzo e buon fine settimana.